On behalf of the ENMU College of Fine Arts and Department of Music, welcome to another outstanding musical performance. Please turn off your cell phones, pagers, and watch alarms at this time. Photography is prohibited during performances. Photographs may be taken when the performance has concluded. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Passes.
Thank you.
So for the next and last portion of the program, I'd like to talk a little bit about Britten's tempo variations and some possible inspirations. Benjamin Britten wrote four pieces for oboe, all of which I adore. They include the six metamorphoses for solo oboe after Ovid, two insect pieces for oboe and piano, fantasy string quartet for oboe and string quartet, and of course, the tempo variations. I've always enjoyed listening to the tempo variations, but without Britten leaving any program notes, sometimes they've been a little difficult to understand. As a performer, I think if you don't have a really thorough understanding of your piece, it can be very difficult to present a musically satisfying performance for both yourself and the audience. So I thought I would combine my love of oboe and music history, do some research, and see if I can figure out how and what combines this piece to make it a unified whole. It's a set of variations that has a theme, and then eight variations, and many of the titles seem a little disparate compared to one another. We have the theme, we have oration, we have march, exercises, some dances, and I thought, what is the thread unifying this composition, especially without any program notes? So what do you think of that quote up there by Benjamin Britten? It's actually in a letter he wrote to the War Board. The whole of my life has been devoted to acts of creation, being by a profession a composer, and I cannot take part in acts of destruction. So let's keep that in mind for the next few minutes, and of course also keep in mind during the time when he's living. Right? So Edward Benjamin Britten was born November 22nd, 2013, in a small British town, seacoast town of Lowestoft, England. And by coincidence or not, St. Cecilia's Day, the music patroness, her day is also November 22nd. By all accounts, he had a rather idyllic childhood. His father, Robert, was a dental surgeon. His mother, Edith, was an amateur pianist and singer who enjoyed music and taught Benjamin at a very young age. He had three older siblings, Barbara, Robert, and Beth. And again, by all accounts, a very nice childhood, academic success in school, music lessons with his mother starting at five. He started composing at age five, and then later he studied viola and composition with local composer Bridge, Frank Bridge. Britten knew early on he wanted to be a composer, so after graduating from boarding school, he attended the Royal College of Music. As a young man growing up in post-World War I, Britten, Benjamin Britten, was quickly swept up in the pacifist movement, which was gaining momentum, especially with the country's talk of rearming. Britten refused to join the officers' training program at his school, and he wrote impassioned essays against it, as well as essays against hunting and animal cruelty. He also wrote of the horrors of the Spanish Civil War with the mass executions, and he was terribly frightened at the possible prospect of war, especially with the buildup of German power in Austria and in Poland. His work, Our Hunting Fathers, also from 1936, deals with the inhumanity of man and also its anti-politics and anti-government. The GPO, the GPO was the General Post Office, and in addition to focusing on mail, the British government would often ask or request them to create British documentary films. And John Grierson led up this film unit of the GPO. And during this time, meaning the 1930s, it was quite popular for artists and intellectuals to emphasize social purpose and political interest through their own mediums. So again, this is very, very popular, and Britten, of course, was very involved in the GPO and also in the BBC. On the next slide, it's a little light. We do have two of his influences. Montague Slater, he worked with at the BBC, and Montague Slater is also the dedicatee of Temporal Variations. The other three pieces are actually dedicated to the oboist that premiered them. So this is our only piece that is dedicated to a non-oboist. Ogden impressionable humanity. So again, you can see that they collaborated on quite a few works. Most of them were for the BBC and the GPO, so they might not be as familiar to you as other pieces. So those are more of his direct influences, what might have directed him, what he was concerned with, what immediately influenced him. So now let's talk for just a few moments on the rise of Hitler, because again, he was fearful of the growing German power in Austria and Poland. So in 1923, Hitler is jailed after an attempted government coup, and during this time, he writes Mein Kampf, where he praises the superiority of the Aryan race, but also denounces the German Jewish population. And it's interesting to note that 2 years prior to this, in 1921, Hitler was elected Führer, or head of the Nazi Party. In 1931, the Nazi Party has approximately 3 million members, and in 1928, they only had about 60,000. So in 3 years, they went from about 60,000 to about 3 million. So that's a very, very large increase in such a short amount of time. In 1933, January, Hitler is elected Chancellor. And in February 1933, the Parliament building is burned down. And they didn't know, and we still don't know, exactly who set the fire. There was a rumor that it was a deranged Dutch gentleman, and other people actually suspected that perhaps Hitler had someone set the fire, because regardless of who the culprit was, he did declare emergency power and banned all political parties. In March of 33, Hitler and the Nazis set forth the Enabling Act, in which he stripped Jewish, German, Gypsy, and other populations of basic socioeconomic and political rights. And in April of 1933, the book burnings begin. Also in 1933, we have the establishment of Dachau. And although it's called a concentration center, or concentration camp, at this time it's really more of a depository for those opposing Nazi propaganda. We know that the extermination's coming, we know that the ovens are coming, but it's still just a little early. Right now it's just more of a containment center. In August of 1934, President Hindenburg dies, and Hitler's dictatorship is now established as Führer, head of the Nazi Party, president, head of state, and chancellor, head of government. So very quickly, he has all elements of the country ruling. And lastly, in 1935, Hitler announced that Germany is going to ignore the Treaty of Versailles. So think of those as more worldwide influences for Britain. The temporal variations was completed on December 12th, and 3 days later, December 15th, it was premiered at London's Wigmore Hall with oboist Natalie Kane and pianist Adolf Hollis. All accounts say that Britain was very pleased with the piece, but it wasn't performed again until 1980, when it was published 4 years after his death. Okay, now I believe in your program you have the list of the movements coming up, so they're a little light. All right, so we're going to play the piece for you now. We'll have some media, and these are helping me, these specific videos, thoughts, and titles of the movement. That are helping me to hopefully create a very, very sensible and meaningful performance for you. Okay.
Thank you.